But their story didn't end there.
How could there have been only one? And he's back in business.
It is the worst idea in the history of bad ideas.
Part two is the final chapter in the violent history of...
This time, it's personal.
Oh, life moves fast. One day you're playing kick the can with kids named Flick and Schwartz.
I triple dog dare you!
And the next thing you know, you're a certified adult.
Ralph! Ralph, dear old man.
Fragile!
He was the best.
Ralphie, promise me we're gonna make this a wonderful Christmas. That would make your father so happy.
I promise. What had I done? And now it was all up to me?
I suggest you start drinking and don't stop till New Year's.
Hey, kids. Who wants to go see Santa?
This is amazing.
Incredible.
We will meet you right here when you're done.
Don't let him kick you in the face.
Huh? It's the happy season.
No, Ian. When it's just us decorating, it kind of feels like child labor.
Honey, it's not labor if we don't pay you.
Yeah.
Cheers.
There'll be much mistletoe.
My dad made this all look so easy.
That doesn't mean it was easy.
The most wonderful time of the year.
Schwartz, I triple dog dare you.
Oh, I got him now.
Geronimo!
That's brutal.
It's the most wonderful time.
Slowly I could feel the Christmas ember beginning to glow again.
Welcome back to The Tonight Show. We've got a great one for you tonight. If you like Chicago in the 1970s, voiceovers, daydreams, bullies, bar tabs, hiding from your wife, memories with family, mall shopping sprints, ice skating injuries off the ice, police officer Scott Farkas, and if you like, isn't that crazy? That's his name. And if you like a little boy all grown up with a family of his own named Ralphie, you're going to like the sequel we're talking about this week. It's a ho-ho-ho Halloween Christmas. Oh, that doesn't make any sense.
Halloween.
I know. We're talking A Christmas Story Christmas, a sequel to the very, I guess, I don't even know what this is. This is like one of the, it's got to be up there in terms of the Christmas movie rankings. The 1983 film A Christmas Story. We're really excited.
That it's got that 24-hour block on TBS every year.
Yeah, so if you don't know this movie...
Haha, very funny.
You probably actually know this movie if...
Without knowing it, yeah.
Yeah, well, it's just like, it's one of those movies where, like, if you like it, you'll watch it, but if you don't, you'll avoid it.
I was like, oh, what, why do people... I think we talked about, like, why does everyone love this movie? Yeah, it's hammered into us, but then I started writing down, like, things without looking up that was memorable about the first one, and I got through a really long list.
Yeah,
it's just I was like leg lamp, sticks. Pink rabbit PJs, the dog stealing the turkey, licking the light pole, Red Ryder BB gun, and then some problematic stuff that I remember reasons. But
yeah, exactly.
I was like, this is actually a really memorable movie. Anyways, welcome to Revenge of the Sequel, the podcast just about sequels. My name is Manuel.
Hey, it's Andrew.
What's up? It's John.
And it's Christmas? When is Christmas this year?
Well, I think it's Thanksgiving right now for us.
Actually, yeah. I know, but people are listening to this in the future.
There's turkey in this. This movie does give you the Christmas spirit, actually. I won't say that. Like, it actually does kind of, when you watch it, it does kind of, you're like, oh, okay, cool. Like, I guess
it gets your chestnuts roasting.
It's Christmas time. Yeah, exactly.
It really hypes me up.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Baby.
It's cold outside.
Yes. This is coming out a full week before Christmas. Yes. But this is our Christmas episode.
This is awesome. This is way better than our last Christmas episode, which is Home Sweet Home Alone.
Do you
which
remember was like last that? Week. Interesting.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, it was last year, last week.
A lot of it has the same beats, too, sometimes a little bit.
A lot of Christmas movies do have
I was like, the, I was like, the bad guy's stuff. A cop in this one. And I mean, so it's the same thing with
what happens with Christmas. You know, in Christmas, you just want to break in to steal some shit. Yeah. Either a star or a present for your kid.
And it doesn't get much like, I think when we think of quintessential Christmas movies, it doesn't get much more holiday themed, I guess,
the Griswolds.
A Christmas Story. And then the Griswolds are great, too, actually. Right. Actually, you know what? Forget the Christmas Story.
We're gonna.
Welcome to the Christmas vacation. Wait, no,
we did a whole month of Christmas sequels. Ago, yeah. So it's it's honestly, first of all, I want to talk about A Christmas Story, the Christmas, original.
Though. We are doing. We should probably specify there is a Christmas Story 2, yeah. Which this podcast is not.
This is
about not. Right
this
now.
Is about the brand new 2022 HBO Christmas Max
story,
release.
Christmas, yeah,
A Christmas Story. Because right, there is a second Christmas Story, but
with
how,
Daniel Stern. Fine actor.
How important was A Christmas Story for you growing up? Although, I'll say this, kind of past our time in a way. But, John, what's the deal with Christmas Story? You a big fan?
I think I've always just known it because of the... actually, no. I think I want to say, like, I probably saw it a little late in life. Like, as in when I got cable. Like, when we got cable, yeah. Like, in the early 2000s. Like, that's probably when I was... fully exposed to it, like fully. I think I had always heard about it because, you know, everyone had seen it. You know, it's from 1983. Like, everyone in my family had seen it, anyone older than me. But I didn't actually start experiencing it, like, myself until, like, you know, I got cable in the 2000s and stuff.
Yeah.
It is a, I don't know, I'm not the biggest fan of the original Christmas Story movie. It is very much of its time, and it's got some good beats, and it is on Christmas Day a lot, right? That's what happens during the, it's at Christmas Eve.
I mean,
that
it
24
does,
hours.
It yeah. I mean, yeah.
The TBS has like a 24-hour block where they play it, and that's mainly where I've seen it. And then when I watch it, like,
well,
you're
an avid TBS viewer when you were as a kid. After like he knew that he wanted to watch Hitch all the time.
Yeah, I was
and
like,
then
what
on
else
Christmas,
is there? Family Guy reruns.
And just Hitch. Like, Hitch, and then the Christmas
Big
Story.
Bang Theory.
George Lopez's old late night show.
Oh no, not okay. Yeah, I forgot about that. Conan, like it had
Conan
late night
was on
TV.
There. Yeah, yeah,
wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Actually, Conan.
Very funny.
Very funny. They don't know drama. That's TNT.
But A Christmas Story. I mean. It's one of those movies because it's on and it's thought of like this classic because it's you know, yeah. it's very old.
It's one of those pop culture things everyone absorbs through osmosis, yeah. Whether you watch it or not.
You know that the
everyone's getting hard from that lamp.
The quotes and the lines, you know, you'll shoot your eye out, kid. You know,
when he says the fuck word.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Oh fudge.
Anytime they yell Ralphie.
Yeah, I triple dog dare
licking
you.
Licking the
stuff
pole.
Like that.
How many Christmas commercials have
I
that
can't
pole
put
lick?
My arms say uncle. Down. Say uncle. And you know,
the bully.
It's very, very iconic in terms of like a very old timey movies
yeah.
from like the 80s. Like, you know, the era of Gremlins, the era of like the Goonies and stuff.
But I feel like we kind of have to figure out like.
As for my like place in the Christmas Story thing, yeah. I was like, it's okay.
Well, that's why it's like it's a little chicken and the egg thing. Like, is it only a big deal because everyone told us it was, and it's on all these commercials and it's ripped off, or was it a big deal so they did all these commercials?
Like, I mean, it's like
I don't know.
It's like what you were saying before we started recording. Like,
why do people like this?
I don't want to generalize.
What's the box office look like?
Because this isn't
opening year.
I mean,
it did. Okay, it cost $3 million. It made 20, but it did respectable. It wasn't like a. Big
was
hit.
It number one?
It's very much of its generation. I think it's like it has a lot of like nostalgia for maybe people who grew up around that time, like, you know. But it's also like, well, no, I mean, it's I don't know. I just think it like it probably resonates with the people who were kids at the time. So like, you know, maybe Gen Xers or something like that. There's nothing wrong with that. It's just like, you know, it's their movie that they grew up with. A lot of people don't really like Jingle All the Way. But I grew up with Jingle All the Way.
Fuck, I love Jingle All the Way
movie.
So much.
And so, like, you know, Phil Hartman, that R.I.P. that to me is like a.
That's your Christmas Story.
Well, it's just like, well, yeah. In a case, like, you know, it's just like it's one of those things where you're just like, yeah, this doesn't age too well by itself, but like as a thing of its time and the nostalgia, like if you grew up with it, that's probably good. And I think A Christmas Story resonates that way. And I think a lot of people still come around to it because of the 24-hour marathons. You know, like it's just it's a staple of.
Yeah,
of
it's
Christmas entertainment,
it's like passed down through generations,
right. Kind of forced on you. Because
if it's Christmas Day, you normally are opening presents for like 5 minutes, and then you got to kill all day.
Yeah, and I was like, this type of entertainment. No offense to that, or like no offense to anyone, but like it's kind of forced on you because you're kind of, you know, one channel actually does play it for 24 hours.
Yeah,
like,
and
you
they've
can't get
been
away
doing
from it.
That since the 90s. So it's
97.
It's like a fairly. I just want before Drew, we talk about. Your, I guess, connection to A Christmas Story. Here was what this year looked like at the box office. It made number one at the box. Do you guys want to guess what number one at the box office was in 1983?
Was it Gremlins? No, it was
think about this year.
E.T.
No.
Indiana Jones.
Return of the Jedi.
Oh, yeah. Nice. Makes
made
sense.
$250. And then Tootsie, Flashdance, Trading Places, War Games, Octopussy, Staying Alive, Risky Business, Mr. Mom. And National Lampoon's Vacation was up there as well. So a fairly big year, I think, for the box office. And, I mean, there's some dramas in here, which is kind of wild that Tootsie was number two.
And TNT knows a lot about.
And they would know. Drew, what did you think about A Christmas Story growing up? And, I mean, we talked about this before the pod, but I told John, too, one of the crazy things about this is the amount of merch that just... You can get A Christmas Story stuff everywhere starting, like, October. And it's crazy because you can't get some Marvel stuff after the movie's been out for 2 weeks, you know? And Christmas Story just, like, has been around forever.
Yeah, I think it's one of those things where it's super relatable to kids because the first one is about getting that gift that you want.
Yeah, and so, getting bullied.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, and just living a regular kid life where it's like, oh, I got bullied, or oh, I hung out with my friends and we did stupid shit or whatever, you know.
And shit, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. What?
I licked every pole I saw as a kid.
Oh, cool.
I knew it.
Light poles. Polish people.
Not heavy ones. Not heavy poles.
What?
Like, because you said light poles.
Oh, okay, I get it. Yeah.
Like only the light people. Like, heavy Polish people.
What about the earth?
Yeah,
poles?
I wasn't. Like, I wouldn't. If you were Polish
and you were heavy,
I would lick you.
No, you didn't lick any like north or south poles.
No. Nice. My mom said,
"Stay
north."
Stop
getting us off track. Damn. Shit.
I think it's one of those things where it's super relatable to kids because everyone wants that one gift, and I guess it's not as adventurous as that, you know, as the movie.
Yeah.
You usually just ask and then it's there.
And we're not all looking for guns.
Yeah, exactly. I liked it growing up. I think we watched it, you know, as soon as we got cable. I have a very similar story to John and stuff like that, but I think that there's this thing with Christmas movies where if you want to watch a good one, you don't really have a lot of choices because they Hallmark pumps like 200 of them out in one day.
And honestly, kind of as a reaction to Netflix, because you're right, like for a while it's the same like dozen movies
for sure. And I think it's one of those things where eventually you always want to watch Christmas movies every year, and after a while one of them gets boring or you need to rotate one out. And I'm like, Die Hard never gets boring. Like, Die Hard always, every year, no matter what, is just spot on every year.
Also great because you can watch it anytime.
And I never want to replace it. And so I get that some people do. Like, I tell people that I rewatch movies and they think I'm weird. Where they're like, wait, you watched it again in the theater a second time or a third time? Wait, I haven't seen that movie since it came out. And I'm like, really, really? Like, that's fucking crazy to me. Like,
meanwhile, they're saving like TikToks and Quibis on their phone.
Yeah, exactly. And so I think in the age of the rewatch now with the streaming services and stuff like that, if you want B-movies and stuff, that's fine. You want to watch a crappy whatever, a Halloween, a Christmas slasher where, you know, it's got a lot of blood and the acting isn't that good. Or
Silent Night, Deadly Night.
Yeah, for sure. There's a lot of those, but if you want the list of the good ones, I think this one is probably towards the bottom of the list of the good ones. But
Christmas Story.
Yeah, right.
Oh, okay, cool.
And that's why I think you bump into it a lot, and that's why you get the big exposure, because people...
There's always someone in your group that likes it.
Well, and there's not like other movies where it's like, I want to watch an Easter movie, or like I want to watch a Valentine's
Passion movie. Passion of the Christ?
Valentine's
Day?
Yeah, I want to watch a Valentine's Day movie. And Halloween, there's a lot of them, because...
Horror.
Yeah, it's just like, oh, it's just scary stuff in general. And so Halloween and Christmas are, I think, the biggest holidays where you want to rotate specific movies out. And that's why I think the exposure is so big to something like this, because you don't really – it's a very limited list.
It's, you know, it, and, you know, I didn't watch this for a really long time. I didn't watch TBS, They Know Funny. I didn't know TBS, so I don't know.
You had no comedy. I don't know. No funny. Sense of comedy. Yeah,
I didn't laugh until I got TBS. But this was, I think, when I watched it, the first thing I thought was like, this is really old, which I think.
When did you watch it?
That was the first thing.
Yesterday. Oh, I was like,
I was like young. I was maybe
damn,
like,
and you still thought
still
this
was
really
like,
old.
This is crazy because there's like a sheen. It's
room
shot
is
on
fucking
film.
Green.
There's like a nice sheen
and
on
it,
everything.
It takes place in 1920s or something like
that. A long time ago, before the war. But also, the movie felt very vignette-y to me because I was like, well, this is all, I guess, connected because the same person. Yeah. but they're sort of not connected thing. Like, it's, oh shit, this thing happened at school. That was wild, right?
Right.
Or like, yeah. This, they're all very separate. And I mean, I think you said it was based on a book, and I looked up the book. It's called In God We Trust, All Others Pay Cash. But it's also like, it's a book of anecdotes. Like, it's a book of vignette, like, of just one-off short stories. And the movie kind of feels that way to me. It's not necessarily even like, it's almost like these movies are, there is a through line. He wants his present. There's obviously like some great family dynamic that carries the movie through. Yes, right, Toretto. Yeah. But, you know, it's you know, on its face, it's a comedy that is innocent. And I guess he says the F word, so never mind. But it's like, you know, it's innocent enough and family friendly enough that it's safe for you to watch with everyone. And I do think you're right. Like, there's just a handful of movies you watch around Christmas time. And this was on the list for most people, especially if it's always on TBS. And I'm sure it's on the background of millions of homes while people are opening presents or whatever.
Right, yeah, for
it
sure.
It does put you in the mood. The Christmas Story movie puts you in a Christmas mood, but and that's like coming from us. We're not in a town that looks like this town. We're in Texas, and it like we're like, oh man, I kind of like.
But
that.
If it was playing like, you know, on like Christmas Eve or something, like, you know,
they love that he's getting a gun in this one. I'm just kidding, Texas.
Thank God. Welcome back. But I feel like that's what makes it super special, and it's also really interesting how you're right. Cable and TV gave it the second life. Kind of like It's a Wonderful Life, which famously bombed until it played on TV again.
Right, yeah.
It's the same thing here. That. Like, I don't think there was a market for Christmas movies in general because you didn't want to go to the movies on Christmas Day. Now it's a massive thing where Disney's releasing a movie for Christmas, you know, right, the audience. Yeah. And this is just playing a huge part of that. Well, when you're at home, you want to stream something that makes you feel Christmassy.
I think that's perfect, too, is what you just said, like, a lot of people don't really want to go to the movies during Christmas.
I don't
think
it was a thing.
But like, if there's like a Christmas, you know, like these Hallmark and Netflix movies do probably wonders
it's a
for
huge
their.
Thing.
I love All of the Other Reindeer, and that's a TV special, like some obscure TV special with Drew Barrymore and
the original Grinch.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
I love that.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Grinch.
We
like,
do watch
must
it.
See. Like
for sure.
I think that's like high. On, the Jim Carrey Grinch, I think, is also really high.
I don't know about that.
I watched the original Grinch, but I do watch that one as well. Jeffrey Tambor's in it though.
Yeah. but yeah, so Christmas Story, I think most people know it. I'm sure it's a universal too, like, you know, pop culture wise. There's a Christmas Story Christmas. A lot of this is
pretty bad title, but like it's meant to be like cheesy and stupid.
Yeah.
Like yeah.
And I'm trying to watch the sequel, Christmas Story Halloween
or Christmas Story 2.
Yeah,
a Christmas Story New Year's.
A lot of time has elapsed. It is 33 years after Ralphie was a little boy. And, you know, he returns home.
Played by the same dude.
Is Christmas Story is a Christmas Story 2 still Ralphie?
Yes, but it's like a couple of years
different
afterwards.
And it's not canon, actor. Or?
I don't think so. Well,
it's not in the ACCU.
The Gene Shepherd universe.
ACSU. The A Christmas Story.
Right, that's his name. Gene Shepherd, right? The original, the author dude?
I don't know.
Gene Shepherd? Damn it.
Gene Shepherd. Yeah, you got
dead air.
Sorry.
He's like, get faster Wi-Fi.
You should click one of those when there was dead air. We had fucking drops we could use. But I forgot what I was going to say.
Yeah.
Oh, but yeah, it's not part of the writer's room of Christmas Story.
Yeah,
the second one.
Okay,
so that's what I wanted to know, because you were like, it takes place X amount of years, and I'm like, did the other stuff happen?
Yeah.
He fought the Sticky Bandits?
This was like a legit like legacy sequel. Like many years later, a lot of the same cast. Like a lot of the same
TBS 2 is playing A Christmas Story Christmas 24/7 now, too.
They will, like in a couple of years.
They kind of know funny. They're not.
It's cool because now you can just alternate them, so it's not a 24-hour block. It's like a 12-hour block of each, probably.
I don't know. They're probably still going to do just... I don't know. We'll have to see. But John, what did you think of A Christmas Story Christmas? Ralphie's back. Hashtag family.
It was wild. I kind of came into this as like, you know, just very curious. Like I didn't know the trailer didn't look that cool. You know,
I didn't even watch the trailer. I don't even know. I didn't know this thing was happening.
It existed until yesterday. Yeah, when I told you. So it didn't look that cool. I knew that Peter Billingsley, that's his name, right?
Yes.
I know he had been around for a while post, you know, A Christmas Story stuff. I think he's like, you know, he's John Favreau's, he's John Favreau's like co-producer, I think, on a lot of the movies.
TV director, all that.
Yeah. And he was also in, I think, Spider-Man No Way Home. Far From Home. And Iron Man, I think. He was, like, people in those. So having, like, announcing, I think they also announced it when HBO Max became a thing. Like, they had, there was an announcement in there in all the announcements that were made about, like, a Christmas Story sequel coming out.
Oh, my God, this is a Legendary Pictures.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I saw that.
Is this part of the monster?
Yeah, the monster. Yeah, Godzilla's in the background.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay, cool.
So I had, like, you know, and then watched, the trailer came out a couple of weeks ago before the movie actually aired. Like, you know, it's just like, you know, the trailer came out literally like a few weeks ago. Wasn't impressed and stuff. Ended up watching it just.
I was like, God damn.
It wasn't. I mean, the trailer, like, it looked weird, and it's just like, okay.
The trailer,
like,
wasn't a Wakanda
John,
Forever.
John, it's Christmas.
Anyway, it's just like, you know, but putting it on and actually finally watching it, and having no intention to do, like, this podcast with it, just putting it on and just, like, enjoying it, I was pleasantly surprised. Like, you know, Peter Billingsley is a surprisingly, like, really good lead person. Like, you know, like, the story this time around, like, follows Ralphie as the lead character, not so much, like, his old man. I mean, he's still narrating, like, the way he did in the original movie, but he's more or less, like, the
beats. But he is narrating, like, in his own voice, which
right,
is
in
cool.
his own in yeah. his own voice, yeah. It's not Gene Shepard's voice. Gene Shepard, the guy who wrote the books and stuff, he narrated the original movie. But, like, watching him do this and then seeing, like, and the movie kind of has similar beats, you know, but the plot is really different. And it is, like, it takes a while. It's really slow getting into it. Like, you know, I kind of don't feel, it's very awkward for, like, 30 minutes or so. And then when the movie starts gets going, it's actually kind of really heartfelt. Like, it's, you know, there's some sad moments in it, and there's some kind of, like, you know, it just kind of works. You know, it has the tone of the original one, and then I think some parts that are, like, more on the cringy side are things that don't work from that era. I'm looking at the caroler. You know, the hiding from the carolers.
I thought that shit was funny.
But
His mom is one of the funnier parts of the movie.
Yeah, we'll get into that too, because I was like, the mom is kind of a different characterization from the original mom.
Recast too, right?
Recast, but also, like, she plays it differently. So, like, it's just, you know, that could just be from the age thing. But we'll get into that. But overall, like, the movie is really fun. Like, I thought it was, like, you know, that his chemistry with the original guys, like, his friends work. His chemistry with his family. His family's hilarious. Like, the two kids are, like, you know, kind of sarcastic and quick-witted kids. Like, they're awesome. His wife is cool. Played by, like, Aaron Hayes, I think. The movie just, you know, it surprisingly works. It's, like, one of those legacy sequels that's kind of like, whoa, this is kind of good. Like, you know, it's not, like, there are some cringy parts. And, like I said, it kind of just, some of the, maybe the faults of the movie is that it hangs a little too hard to the nostalgia of the first one. But, you know, beyond those parts, like, it's actually a really good Christmas movie. Like, I think it does the legacy sequel, you know, status right.
Yeah, and you're right. Like, its mandate is to kind of recapture something really warm and nostalgic, like the first one.
I think it's also, like, it very much aware. I mean, it's obviously doing the nostalgia on purpose. But, like, you know, Christmas, I think I was telling you before we recorded, like, Christmas is a holiday where a lot of people do get nostalgic for shit.
You reflect on your year.
Yeah, you're just like, oh, remember when I got this for that, or, you know, this shit for this Christmas or something like that.
I mean, this is, we're going to spoil parts of this movie, but, you know, like, it's very raw in terms of...
Oh, totally.
You know, his dad dies, like, you know.
And that's, like, that's also, like, one of the more deeper, if it is, I mean, it's, I don't know if it's that deep, but it's also one of the more, like, you know, actual... like, serious parts of the movie is the fact that, like, you know, you're dealing with the loss of, you know, Christmas sometimes won't be
the same.
I mean, it won't be for everybody, like, the same every year. Yeah. Like, eventually it's going to have to change. So, like, I think that's, like, a pretty cool angle to go with it. And then, you know, and throwing the weight of the stuff that has to happen, throwing it on Ralphie's shoulders to make him, like, you know, this very likable protagonist in the movie.
Yeah. Drew, what did you think of A Christmas Story Christmas?
I think, like John, I was very surprised because the first one is nothing to phone home about, but it is a pretty good feel good, like, you know, Christmas
movie. It's kind of silly, yeah.
Yeah, it's fun to have fun with and stuff like that. So this one, it kind of surprised me because I didn't think that, you know, he was still going to have it in him for being a leading man and all. But he does really, really good, a really good job. I appreciate the nods to the old one because it does capture a lot of the same beats. But it feels like a greatest hits of other Christmas movies also. Like the remember when he double dog dares or he triple dog dares them to go down the sled or whatever. Yeah. And I was like, man, this is exactly like Clark Griswold's. The sledding, remember he goes on the sled and like he goes so fast that it's wild. And so there's a lot of those same beats. And we talked about how Buzz is the cop in the first one, in the other Home Alone movie. And it's kind of the same way here with what's
Scott Farkas.
Yeah, Scott Farkas. But it is really fun to see the cast return. It is also kind of wild that it knew that we grew up. So everybody who's watched it for forever knew that we grew up, and I talked about how relatable the first one is because as a kid, there's that gift you want, you know, and so it kind of relates to you then. And now it knows that we grew up, and so it knows that we're going to be dealing with these very adult issues very quickly, which is losing people that we love because we're older now, and that's time, you know.
And for him to be to understand, like, he is his dad in the first movie to his kids, like, it's a pretty like big revelation, I think,
for him. Yeah, and so it's just kind of wild on how self-aware it is, because,
well, it's also like the fact that, like, even when it comes to the humor, like, they're transposing and they're like giving these moments, like these little beats from the first movie, on a modern, like, you know, adult twist.
Modern,
like, you know,
but also 70s, yeah.
What's also, I mean, but yeah, but like at one point, like, you know, when the beginning is like, he wouldn't be able to show his place in the playground again. And then this one is just like, oh, he's going to the lowest bar? Like the seventh circle of, like, of hell of bars or something like that.
And it's you're like, just kind of like the iCarly thing where it's so like, funny. What the?
It's like, yeah, you're talking, you're making it seem like this is like a children's story for like adults. Like these people go
it's
to
in
the
voice
bars.
Of the book.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Go on.
It's really it's something that I didn't expect from this movie to kind of touch upon, because whether you like it or not, that's something that you're going to be dealing with, where like this holiday is kind of not the same, and now it's on you to kind of make it what your parents did for you, you know.
Yeah.
And so it's just kind of wild.
Stuff you inherit, basically. Yeah.
Like, yeah, for sure. And so it's
traditions
it's,
you inherit.
Mm-hmm. And it leans into that, and it's got a really, really solid message of, like, it's funny because we've been talking about on how I think at one point my family specifically, they're like, man, we should change it up because it's getting like routine and it's getting old and stuff like that. But as I grow up a little more, I'm like, man, this is like just this is still the best, like just to hang out with everybody.
Right. Yeah.
And the time's going to be, you know, past, like we're not going to get a lot of these left and stuff like that. So I think that's the cool part where it kind of resonates with me here specifically, because it knows that we grew up, which is just kind of cool. I think that I think a lot of things are starting to have to do this, like, you know, the MCU, where it's like it's been 15 years. How do you keep those kids that were kids back in the day engaged for another 5 years, another 6 years, 7 years? And it's just kind of wild to see this type of long-term storytelling.
Yeah, and I think that this movie decidedly is a movie for people who are of a certain age and fans of the original Christmas Story. Yeah. It's not necessarily trying to do everything that the first one did, because it's such like a singular, special thing. It actually kind of interrogates like his point of view as a kid in the first one,
right,
and his point of view now. I do appreciate how it does a lot of the things that we really enjoyed. Like, the characters are still very kind of over the top, you know, like everyone in the bar, everyone who comes to the house is still, no one's normal.
It's very slapsticky still.
It is.
Yeah.
And even though the movie is really grounded because it deals with death and it deals with other really adult rejection, like the fact that your career doesn't go the way you want it to.
Those might actually make it feel a little uneven, but we can get into that. Like, because of the grounded tones, like, are kind
for
of a little
sure.
serious.
Yeah. Not even skirting some of the things that are, like, the first movie doesn't even attempt to do some of this stuff.
Right, yeah.
But I do still appreciate that he daydreams, and his daydreams are still as fanciful and as imaginative as when he was a kid. Like, there's a Western, there's him winning the Pulitzer Prize.
It makes sense on why he became a writer, because he's got that wild imagination.
For sure, and I think that's, like, one of the things that I'm glad they carried over, and it's not too heavy-handed. It's a nostalgic movie, don't get me wrong. There's like notes and hints of the first film, you know, like the tree. There's like stuff like that, but nobody wears a pink bunny outfit. We don't see that leg lamp real. Like, we see it, the stuff briefly, but again, like, this could have gone like, I haven't seen Christmas Story 2, but maybe it does a lot more of that. Like
the beats.
Can you imagine if he's like, I know what my kid should wear, you know, or whatever. Like,
you should go lick that pole, you know?
I licked it exactly in that same place. Like, all fucked up and gross.
I quadruple dog dare.
Yeah. I'm also like, I'm glad that there's still the elements of like bully. I'm not glad that bullying exists, but I'm glad that it's in the movie, you know, like that his kids are kind of dealing with some of the same things that he was. There were some like, kind, and I have to remind myself, well, it's not modern, it's the 70s, but there's like that part in the beginning where his son's like looking at a bra, which I was like, okay, that's like, that felt like the first movie, but something that I wouldn't have put it now. Like,
on this one,
in the first one, but I get, been, it's the 70s.
That's true. I mean, it might have been doing, not that it's wholesome, but like, I mean, it might have been a little more, looking. It's a little more wholesome here than it was in the 70s.
Cause
I
For think, sure,
like,
yeah.
Because Ralphie runs his arm up the leg.
Which is why they don't show the leg, which I appreciate.
Yeah, they don't show the leg because it's very much of it.
Sexualized.
Yeah, I'm not even, because, yeah, like, the comedy would not land. It would land differently.
The 80s had, like,
You'd have to throw a man leg in there, too, at the same time.
Well, in the rewatch, I was like, what was funny about this?
Well, the 80s was like, yeah,
a child is touching an adult.
Well, it's like edgy, right? Like, you know, the 80s had, like, sex comedies, like Porky's and shit, you know? So it's like, you know, you throw something in there, like, it's not the full Monty.
I'm just kidding. I'm
the 90s. But, like, you know, it's just saying, like, you know, those are, it was very edgy. Like, you know, you throw that in there, you're like, oh, shit.
A little something for daddy.
Something like that. Yeah, I guess so, yeah.
Yeah, and I appreciate that the movie doesn't do too much
of that.
No, definitely. I do like the ending still. It does feel incredibly nostalgic, even apart from it having to even, like, reference the first film, just nostalgia as, like, a...
ending one here.
Yeah, just, like, as a device or as, like, a human emotion to go back home, to relive memories, and for them, memories are clips of the first film, but also for you to deal with the fact that you have to make your own because they're just memories.
Well, yeah, because nostalgia can only go so far, and I think that's what the movie's about.
Well, and it's funny because I know that everyone that's a human always looks back on their life, and it's like, I used to be into this and that, but I think, like, we're starting to see that our generations were able to capture that more in general, like through pictures, like that, because at some point the tech didn't exist, and so now we had the camcorders and stuff like that where you can watch, you know, the VHS tapes of it or whatever.
Yeah,
and so
back in the day, like, only rich people had to get, like, you know,
exactly. 16 millimeter movie. But now, where everyone has the capability of filming anything they want and then watching anything that they want from their past, now nostalgia is way bigger than it ever was because you're able to look back on it. And so I think,
and let's be honest, most people don't even look at the 10,000 pictures on their phone.
We live to live in the past, I think, and relive the good times and stuff like that. So that's why I think nostalgia is just so prominent, specifically with our generation right now.
I will say, I don't know. Like, I feel like this movie, and you can tell from just the scope of the film that it probably had a moderate budget. You know, like, they don't really do anything fantastical. There might not be any CGI in this or anything like that.
I mean, they made a replica of the house from the first movie, which probably cost a lot of money. Cool,
but
I think the throw up was CGI.
Wow.
Oh yeah.
Definitely.
You can tell.
There's a part of me that wished that they had, like, stylistically just decided to shoot this movie on film, like the old one or something. Because it is very, like, a clean, modern-looking movie set in the 70s, referencing the 40s. But I don't know. Like, I guess that would have been just, like, too expensive, you know, at that point.
Might have been
on
the
film.
Extra thing. Well, I mean, because you're right. The movie itself, too. I think that's the one of the big, maybe the biggest strength of the movie is that it recaptures the tone of the first movie. Like, all the nostalgia stuff would be a little hokey. I mean, it's still a little hokey, but, like, it would be, I guess, hokey-er had it been, like, a failed attempt or something like that. You know, like, if it was just trying to cash in on it. But I think, like, because the movie feels the way it feels like it should have been from, like, the 90s or, like, you know, maybe early 2000s, like, maybe, like, where Elf.
And I'm sure it's like around. I'm sure it was like a function of, like, how old is Billingsley? We can't, like, set this in 2020. He would be, like, 90.
Yeah.
Like, my dad died. And they're like, damn, at 160 years old. So I understand it. Like, they couldn't do that. And I think I brought up, I don't know if it was, like, on a virtual pod or something, that I also recently watched Hocus Pocus 2.
Oh, yeah.
Which sort of does the same thing. Like, the movie's the first one's kind of farcical, kind of not necessarily, like, all seamless together.
Right.
And then the second one kind of interrogates that, grounds it a lot, and then it becomes super sentimental at the end. while still like hitting a lot of the same stuff. So this movie's
kind of like that too, because it's just like, yeah. it's a take. Like it's not, it's
set in the world. It stars a character from it and it gives you maybe some sequential, it doesn't go full JJ. It, like it goes part JJ. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like it gives you some of the things and like whispers of the first film. And maybe like just like some stylistic stuff, because honestly, I don't know a Christmas Story movie without the writing from the first one or the like the daydreams,
right,
or the fantastical characters. Like you need that in a Christmas Story movie, but it doesn't it doesn't do too much to make you think that you're just watching a repeat of the first one.
Right, exactly. It never gets to like eye rolling status. Yeah. Where you're just kind of like, oh, this is kind of dumb.
Which some people do criticize it. They're like, oh, this is a replica of the first one. But I'm like, I don't think so. Like, I don't know what they wanted. Like, did you want like a gritty horror movie?
Yeah. I mean, I think this is the best they could have done with the, like I said, like it's, there is a lot of like, I think I said it in the first impressions, like it, there is a lot of like actual, there's probably like a lot of callbacks. There is a lot of callbacks.
Not there is. There's actually like maybe so many, a lot, like every 10 minutes.
But yeah. I think the way they're twisted into the new context and the way the plot, like the how different the plot is, like kind of like saves the movie.
And it's like warm and heartfelt. Like when he wanted his BB gun in the first movie, it's like a Western shootout. In this one, it's a snow fight, a Western shootout with his family.
Right.
And you know, because he's grown. And it's nice. It does like, you know, do the same exact,
shoots his daughter's eye out.
Like it's upgrade. It's not even just upgrade. It's just like adapted to who he is now. Like he's
right. Yeah. And I like that. And I like that he's able to seamlessly, because of like the town and the situation, because of the way the movie is like all slapsticky, like he's able to jump back into old situations with like, you know, Flick and Schwartz, which is like,
and you brought up a good point. You know, they made the choice to make him a writer, an aspiring writer at the beginning, and then, spoiler alert, he kind of becomes a writer at the end.
Right, yeah.
Because of the obituary that he writes. But what did you think about the decision to make it about, the decision to make him a writer? I know, like, Gene Shepard's book and his voiceover was so important to the first movie. What do you think about a movie about a writer, I guess? Or making him, that is his career path, and that's what he wants to do with his life.
It's funny, because I think the recent Halloween movie did the same thing, and I kind of hate it when it happens, because it gives the main character an avenue to retell things, if that makes sense.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
And so I'm like, damn it, like, this is the cliche thing, like, oh man, what the fuck are they gonna tell me about, like, back then, or whatever. The cliche
was built into this one, though.
Yeah, and also, it's pretty wild because of the way it ends, where it's like, it makes it seem like this is a prequel, like, this shows you why he's narrating the first one, because in the first one, you never really question why he's telling the story as an adult, like, why isn't he telling it as a kid?
Yeah, it's like a memory for him, he's recalling. Yeah.
And so, in this one, he straight up goes into the first one, and you're like, oh, shit, like that's fucking wild. And so and obviously, you know, the writer being the narrator in the first one, like, it makes sense to make it come full circle. And I love it because he comes to terms with who he is and an identity. It's almost like he isn't quite okay until he faces his past and he sees on how his his dad was able to, you know, he was forged by, like, he becomes okay with everything. Like, you should see they're heading to his town. The daughter's like, you say this things about this town like all the time. And then here he is finding comfort in his friends and finding comfort in family. And, you know.
And he talks like a writer in this.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Not even into the flashbacks and the voiceover, but just the way he talks to his kids. And
Yeah. And so.
He's making up shit on the fly.
It's like a full realization of, like, now when he comes to terms at the end of, like, oh, this is who I am and this is, you know, what I'm going to write about. Suddenly he hits it, because everything else before that, it's almost like it was fake because he didn't know who he was.
And it's crazy that you bring that up, because it's like a really fun device, because like his memories of the first movie are the movie, you know, is a Christmas story in a way. And that's kind of like a cool inventive way. And I want to shout out the writer, because, you know, Gene Shepard definitely helped write the first one, and, you know, it's part of why it's, you know, why it is the way it is. But Nick Schenck took on the task of, I guess, like, speaking a little bit with his voice
for this one.
And he's like Clint Eastwood's writer. He wrote Gran Torino, The Judge, the Mule, and Cry Macho.
You know what that means? It means he's a giant Christmas Story fan. That's probably what it was. Like, it's just like, oh, do you want to write this? He's like, hell yeah, I want to write this.
I'm in. Yeah, I'm used to writing for Clint.
Yeah, for old.
Yeah. And then this director is Clay Cadis,
Who directed the Christmas Chronicles, which was like a hit on Netflix. So he's no stranger to Christmas movies.
He animated, he's from the Disney, he animated on like every big Disney movie since Pocahontas.
Nice.
Like all the big ones. But you're right. Like he also directed like Angry Birds. So Christmas Chronicles. And I think like they did a fine job of adapting something like this. And I'm not even sure if they went to HBO or if HBO was like, no, we're making a Christmas Story sequel.
Yeah, no, that's, I guess we can probably dig to find that out. But like, it's wild that the fact, this isn't the final thoughts, but I was like, it's just wild that it works. Like the whole movie does. Cause I was like, it's very enjoyable. I almost kind of want to say that you can throw this on a rotation, when you're watching like, you know, Christmas movies every year. Like you can watch A Christmas Story and this like back to back. And it might be, I mean, it's the only thing that'll be jarring is the literal time jump, because like one movie looks like
different,
and then the other one doesn't.
Or maybe do it the way Drew would watch it. I think maybe you'd watch this one first and then you watch A Christmas Story. Here's his article.
I mean, like, that's totally true. I like Drew's take on that. I think he said that when he was like, when we were watching the movie, he was like, oh, he's like, this is a prequel, because he's like, he's telling this. I mean, he's already telling the original movie from the future anyway. So he's just like, yeah.
And he's remembering, you know, stuff.
Yeah, exactly. So that's pretty cool.
So do we assume he moves back?
I don't know.
Because he can write from anywhere, I guess, right?
But I mean, it.
But he's writing for the paper in the town, right?
Well, yeah, I don't know. Was there, I guess I don't remember the ending.
We need another movie.
Did he get a call from like a publisher, or is he just like, oh, the paper's going to be like, I thought that was the paper.
They asked him I thought it was the paper, and it was like, hey, do you have any more stories?
So the paper.
Yeah. But, and so
I guess it's
like the obituary for the paper.
I'm sure he'll write stories for the paper.
So he's just, it's publishing, regardless of
what.
And
it's also the 70s.
Yeah, he's published.
It's the 70s, so a newspaper writer's getting paid like $1 million a year.
Probably.
Back then. Yeah. And now you're
we just dated ourselves by saying like $1 million.
Yeah. He's like, you're a millionaire now. You're writing one article for us. And they're like, whoa.
For a small town.
I know. Yeah. Now they're like, per page, it's like a cent or something. All right, we're going to play a really quick fun game, and
they're laughing at the poverty of like news.
I know, I feel so bad, but like, I mean, I'll say this:
get a tabloid job, guys. No, just
like, well, like, also the heads of newspapers were so resistant to technology in the beginning that they could have owned everything that we use.
You know what I'm interesting. Yeah.
New York Times had people like who were working on a Twitter type thing like in the 90s, and they were like, no computers.
Ooh.
They could have had their own, like,
man, they dug their own grave.
They were so like, no. You got to buy our paper. All right, whatever. Fuck it. We're going to play a Christmas movie game, because it is the holiday week for our listeners.
It is.
This is Off the Dome. You're going to go back and forth, and I guess we'll start with Drew, because John, you won. Well, you get to decide, Drew. But we are just, this is a balls to the wall quickie game where you will have to name a Christmas movie, but here's the thing: one from each franchise. So you can't say, "Well, I'm not gonna
like the Santa Claus 4 or something."
Looks like somebody already used one. No, but for example, you can't say Christmas Story, and then the next one's Christmas Story 2, and then a Christmas Story Christmas. Like once it's off the board, they're all off the board.
Okay,
and you'll just go back and forth until somebody runs out. Do you want to do strikes, or do you think there's enough that we don't need to do strikes?
I think we
can do two strikes.
Two strikes.
Okay, two strikes. You're out in the spirit of Christmas. We got rid of that third strike. So Drew, would you like to start? Or do you want John to start?
There's a scene in it's playing in the background, but there's that scene which is really funny where like the neighbor kid is like, "It's open season on us." Dumbass.
Yeah, he calls him a dumbass. So like, I think that's like him.
That other kid is pretty funny. Like that Bumpus, like where all the hounds the come hounds? From. Like,
that's funny as fuck.
The dogs just keep like bothering him. That's just funny. And those are long living dogs. Those are around from the.
They have little bit little dogs. You see it in this one.
They
They outlive the old man.
Yeah. No, those aren't the same dogs.
John can go first.
Those aren't the same dogs. 33 years, those dogs are 30.
He says the Bumpus Hounds were tormenting my old man the whole life. They just probably just breed.
Yeah, they breed. I was like, good. They got 40-year-old dogs running around. That's crazy. So, John, you're going to go first. What's your first Christmas movie? And we're going to try to go fast. Okay. So don't be like, And I guess like I will be the arbiter whether it's a Christmas movie or not.
Okay.
Because if it's a movie and then they just like say Merry Christmas at the end and get out of there.
Whatever.
So
John,
again,
stop looking over there.
So Wonder Woman is out. Or 1984.
Iron Man 3.
Okay, that's fine, I guess. Iron Man 3 is John's. You get it? Because Wonder Woman 1984, the whole movie, at the very end, it's like a Christmas movie. You're like, what? Yeah, yeah, it's like snowing.
Sure. I remember that. Yeah.
You got to watch it. Like, the whole movie's wild. And I think it's because it came out during Christmas that year. So they were like, throw in a scene. It's wild. Drew.
Just Friends.
Nice. Mm. Okay. John.
Oh, shit. You know what?
There's a lot of good, like, rom-com.
Forgiveness.
The Christmas Chronicles.
Okay, nice. Drew?
Love Actually.
Okay. I think somebody's watching a little bit of Hugh Grant in Four Weddings and a Funeral.
National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation.
There is a little bit of echo. I hear it. But it's not going to be in the pod. Drew?
Die Hard.
Yeah, that's fine.
Is that really?
Yeah, I think we count. I think
Bruce Willis himself.
Yeah, there's a couple. Yeah, but there's a bunch of merchandise that says it is.
Yeah, it is now. Okay.
A very Harold and Kumar Christmas.
That's a good one.
I've never seen it. It's the only Harold and Kumar movie I've never seen.
Okay. There's a sequence in that movie.
Don't fucking.
No, I'm not gonna spoil anymore. But it's a direct reference to A Christmas Story, and it's. Crazy.
Okay.
You should
like,
watch it.
So it's wild that we actually like brought it up.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, but it's a very Kumar version, Harold and Kumar version of it. You could probably guess it, actually.
Weed, probably. No doubt.
There's weed involved, but yeah.
Oh, okay.
God, you got to watch it.
A Christmas Story.
Okay. He said the title of the movie.
Quick one, yeah.
The title of the episode. Okay, John?
The Santa Claus.
Okay, we're just going to do one strike, because I feel like there's a lot of Christmas movies. Drew?
How the Grinch Stole Christmas.
Oh, that's a good one. And that is all of the Grinchiverse.
Shit. Okay, we're running out of Home Alone 2.
Okay, that's good. Drew?
Black Christmas?
That's a good one.
Oh, that's a good one.
John?
Krampus.
And so everyone listening, like, write this down, because you could fill up your whole, like, day with this. Yeah. And, like... Home Alone 2, there's a bunch of Home... We did Home Alone last year, too.
We did Home Alone 2. There's a new one? No, 2 years ago. Oh, no, we did the Home Sweet Home Alone last year.
Yeah, with then Ellie Kemper.
Home Alone 2, like 2 years ago. Yeah. There's a lot of Home Alones. Yeah. There's a plethora of Home Alones.
Yeah. A lot of kids being left.
Yeah, being alone, yeah.
Drew?
Deadpool?
Okay.
Yeah.
Deadpool 2, right?
Yeah, 2.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All the other Deadpools are taken.
I was trying to think. I was like, no, I don't think I have it.
Yeah, he wears a Christmas hat.
Yeah, so it just... counts.
Yeah. Kiss, Kiss, Bang, Bang.
Okay. Do you get any more in your tank?
I might not.
And here's what I'll say. We've said a lot of them during this pod, like as, you know, just yeah, as we've been talking and stuff.
There's definitely a lot, too. Like, it's just like, I'm trying to think of...
There's like a really big one.
Like, we're not even talking really franchises, right? We're just talking about any Christmas movie?
Or no? Any Christmas movies, yeah.
Yeah, the Polar Express.
Oh, that's a really good
one.
That we got to do, like, a list at some point.
Elf.
Ooh, that's a good one.
Damn, he got me real good on that one. Holy shit. Jingle All the Way.
That's a good one.
Ooh, that is a franchise, too. That does
there's multiple.
It has two movies.
Oh, jing, jing, jingle holy in shit. The I'm morning. Running,
John, it's your turn.
I'm running out of fucking movies. Hold on.
I don't have one. I don't think after this. That was like my last...
Christmas.
I don't know.
I'm Up It's Christmas? Is that such a thing?
That counts, yeah. Well...
Is that such a movie, though?
Hold it on. Is not called that. Do you want to... I'm not going to give it to you, because it has very
Mickey's
specific...
Once Upon a Christmas. How about that?
Wait, no, you already said it. That was your strike, fool. Christmas with the Cranks.
Oh, that's a good.
Oh,
one.
Shit.
I watched that one in theaters. Oh, do you remember that movie?
Yeah. Four Christmases.
Oh, yeah, that's a good one.
He already had his strike.
Shut the fuck up.
He did.
I will say this.
Bad Santa.
Oh, yeah. I was going to say that's a good franchise, too.
That's a fucking funny movie. And the three Bs, the butt fucking, booze, and whatever the
oh,
hell.
Oh, damn.
Was. The three Bs of Christmas or something like that. Fuck. Hold on. What's another one? Fred Claus.
Okay. I remember that movie too. That's with Paul Giamatti, right? And
yeah, it's got like Vince Vaughn in it.
Violent Night with David Harbour, now premiering this year.
Future movie.
Boom.
Silent Night, Deadly Night.
Okay. I think that's a
very famous
talk Krampus.
Horror.
There's still room, I think, for more Christmas horrors. Sometimes I want to see horror.
I mean, there's still there's probably
like for
more Christmas
for,
horror.
I'm not saying for the list, but I'm saying for people to make now. Like somebody make some horror? More good ones because.
Well, like, Black Christmas has been made like how many times?
I know, but like, you know, it doesn't have to be a slasher. Like, find a new take. I enjoyed Krampus, even though it was like kind of a...
Goofy. Yeah. It was goofy, right?
Mm-hmm. It told that line, yeah, because you had like little candy men.
Like, yeah, like the gingerbread people.
And the
like...
ending is wild. Yeah, it's whatever.
Scrooged.
Nice.
Shit. How's the... What's the other fucking... I'm pretty sure I have like more Christmas movies.
It's one of those things where you see a list and you're like, oh yeah, how didn't I think of that one?
There's a lot.
Yeah.
You got really close on one.
One? What do you mean?
No, don't tell him.
Oh, okay.
What are you doing? You're helping him.
What do you mean? Like,
what do you mean by that? Like, yeah, just give me the answer.
You started saying one, but you just couldn't get it right.
Shit, hold on.
No, what the fuck? You're just
giving it. It was the Muppets one, but I was like, I don't know the name of it, though. So like, I'm just
what are you doing?
Dig deep in your heart. You probably know that one.
They do.
You're trying to get him to
win. It's like maybe one of the best Muppets movies ever. Probably.
Fuck.
But you don't have to think Muppets. There's a lot of movies out there. John?
Oh my god.
Give him a time.
No. Hold on. Not like...
Four.
Kiss Save Santa or something. I don't know.
What the... Three. Two.
I don't know. How this one?
One. John, you've lost.
The Night Before.
Oh, yeah. The Night Before.
No, I already got it.
It was a Muppets Christmas Carol.
Ah, and there's like, also lots of Christmas carols, too. You could have probably just said like a Christmas
carol. All Dogs Go to Heaven Christmas. What is it called?
Yeah,
wasn't there a Christmas one?
Shoot. Oh, It's a Beautiful Life. What's the one?
It's a Wonderful Life.
That was a pretty big one that y'all didn't get. Last Christmas was pretty recent. Klaus was nominated.
I was going to say Hawkeye at one point.
That, yeah.
Because I was like, I saw a superhero thing. That was
I don't know. Miracle on 34th was a good... That's a remake. Nightmare Before Christmas. Does that count? I don't know. Gremlins is a Christmas
movie, yeah.
Technically, too. And that's one that we talked about. And
bam, 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 bam. The first Gremlins movie.
The Holiday.
The Gremlins 2 is not a Christmas movie.
I would have taken Little Women. Edward Scissorhands.
Where would you have taken them?
The Night Before to church.
I said The Night Before, foo.
You did. Shazam's on here. Is that a Christmas movie?
Yes.
Yeah, you're right.
That was the other superhero thing that I forgot.
Batman.
Batman Returns.
All the Charlie Browns. That was on the list.
Batman Returns is a Christmas movie. Fucking hell. Yeah,
that was all. Okay, I'm going to count how many y'all got, because I feel like that went on a while, which was
impressive.
Like
most impressive.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21. You got 30 Christmas movies.
Wow. That's wild.
And that's like not counting all of the sequels that are attached to them.
Probably,
but,
yeah.
I had 16. John only had 15.
But there's a lot of Christmas movies out there.
31. Well,
any like big sequences from A Christmas Story Christmas that like stands out to you? It's kind of a super heartfelt movie.
Yeah, still. I think the first time watching it, I was watching it with my girlfriend, and I was trying to hide my face because I was getting choked up.
When?
Towards the end, when they find the presents from the dad.
I that know that's was kind wild.
Of, well, yeah,
that he got them everything. They
that's
wanted.
Like a real.
It's funny because like on the surface. Yeah. Like, of the plot, yes, Drew is like, oh, he got them every... Like, you know, miraculously, like, the magic, like, you know, he like, just miraculously knew.
Right after they lose all their presents.
Yeah.
You know, it's like the perfect timing.
The timing is like, you know, it's like, all right, come on. But the way it's executed and the way the tone is and the way, like, the build-up to it, I don't know, man. It's just like it
it's devastating.
It got me. I was just like, ouch. And like,
I'll say this without adding names. We knew someone whose significant other passed away and has not yet opened the present that she got. Him.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, that's what I saw. I was like, oh man, this is like so.
Yeah. That's why. And I think that speaks to, and this is going to be just a small tangent because I do want to get back to this moment. Yeah.
But let's talk about death.
But no, it's also like, this is why some of this stuff feels a little weird when it comes to this movie. Like, I mean, I love these heartfelt moments and you're just like, wow, this is grounded. It's only because, like what you said, like the first movie didn't attempt like anything like this.
No.
So this is what kind of makes this
I'm
movie
I'm trying to
kind
think what the
unique.
Biggest conflict was. He didn't get the thing he wanted.
Yeah, yeah.
He and got soap in his mouth.
Or the dinner was ruined because the hounds came in and ate it or something like that.
Yeah, and then they went to a place.
Yeah, exactly. But like... Seeing, like, I don't know, like, having that moment in this, and then, like, I don't know, it kind of got me. And I was just like, wow, that shouldn't have hit as hard as it hit, but it did. And the same thing goes for, like, you know, the ending. You know, we're just like, you know, oh, the old man's here. He's just like, you know, he's always been here and stuff. Yeah, like, and I do like the ending where it does, like, warp into, like, Gene Shepard's voice from the first one. Like, I think that's a perfect ending, and that kind of does.
It's actually kind of brilliant. Like,
yeah, exactly. That's like a wow, like,
he's closing his loop.
What's also, yeah, exactly. You watch this movie, and then even if you didn't like the whole thing, you're like, oh shit, like that's pretty cool. Yeah. Like, you know, it links it together. But yeah, that was wild. Like, I didn't expect to be hit by a sequel, like the Christmas Story.
And it's the balancing act that the first movie didn't have to worry about, which is like, you're right. Like, he's looking at pictures of his dad. There's a shot of the empty chair, and he's probably imagining his dad.
Right,
like, it's that stuff mixed with, you know, kind of the farcical fantasies that he's having in his head. And, you know, there's some sequences that I was like, well, I don't understand. And I had to remember, like, it's the 70s. Even that's why I was like, I wish they had filmed it on film or made it look aesthetically more nostalgic. More 70s,
throw a filter on it.
Throw a damn filter on it, because I had to keep reminding myself that it's not now. Because there was like the mall sequence where he's like shopping and sprinting and stuff.
That was a little modern. And too modern, like, for 70s.
And I totally forgot it was the 70s during that part, you know? But then I was like, oh yeah, I forgot it is. The most 70s thing is, I think, is when they're in Chicago and you see all the old cars and crap and Al Capone comes out. No, that's like way too old. But it's you know, but there are some sequences where I was just like, it seemed super modern. And part of it is how they tackle themes.
They wait by the landline to get a call.
Yeah, so, and then I'm like, nobody's on Facebook. That's like, that's what Christmas is. Everyone being like, look at this guy on Facebook.
Yeah, everyone celebrates online now. No one does like, in person.
I'm going to Facebook Live. And then there's that, like, that funny thing where he ate all the casseroles, right? Like, do you remember that? Like, that dude.
I don't know if that was a plot point from the first one. I think it's because
So they never got the food in the first one because the dogs ate it. And so this time, they're about to get it. And then,
What did you think about the bar stuff, too? Like, or I guess not even beyond that, like, the old cast, apart from Ralphie and his family, like the officer and his best buds.
Right, yeah.
And the bar that they run. Like, what did you think about seeing Denim again? And maybe even the level of involvement that they have. Because it wasn't too much about, like, they weren't as...
They didn't go balls to the wall like they could have.
Yeah, not like the first movie at all.
I like that. I mean, because, like, you know, the emphasis is Ralphie on his family. So, like, you know, interacting with the old friends... I think it was enough, because, you know, when he interacted with his old friends, there was basically callbacks to the first movie. Like, you know, there's the triple dog dare and shit like that.
Yeah.
I thought it worked. You know, it's cool because, like, they're all very different. You know, they're obviously not kids anymore. So, like, it's really cool seeing them on different ends of the, like, you know, they're obviously, the characters are still exaggerations of who they were, like, on the first movie. But I thought it worked. And surprisingly, everyone who returns from the first movie, like, acts really good. Like, you know, yeah. I haven't followed, you know, those actors obviously since, I mean,
I'm gonna read them up. Flick, Schwartz,
yeah,
and then Officer Scott Farkas,
yeah, it's played by Zach Ward. Actually, Zach Ward is probably the person I've seen the most, you know, of all these people, like, growing up, I guess.
Resident Evil, but also his little brother comes out too.
He sued Scott Farkas sued Christmas Warner Brothers.
I think at one point he did actually, but like, I thought it worked, like, it having all these, like, little callbacks, and I think that's what makes this Legacy sequel kind of cool, is the fact that, like, you have these old people in kind of, like, roles where you'd be like, again, it's just like, oh, this is kind of embarrassing a little bit.
You can watch one or two of the takes on Clerks 3 for some of the old people that he got, and you're like, damn, that wasn't that good of acting, but it was cool to have them there.
In this one, it's the opposite,
where it's like...
Well, they're actually kind of acting pretty good, like, in this one.
Yeah, exactly, where it's like, man, like, everyone's on... Well, and not to mention that Kevin Smith didn't use actors in the first one.
That's true.
There were people who lived in the town, and so he gets them again, and you can tell they're not actors. But these guys, you can tell they're actors.
Yeah, yeah. And I do think that, like, I think, you know, I think, let me look up the name. I think there's definitely a difference between Melinda Dillon, who played Mrs. Parker in the original movie.
Yeah, I noticed that. I Googled, like, is this the real? Because I've seen...
This one, Julie Haggerty is...
I've seen her in a lot of things, and I was like, wait, that was the mom of A Christmas Story the whole time? Because I've seen her in, like...
Yeah, Julie Haggerty is a comedic actress. She's been in lots of comedy stuff.
She's in freaking Airplane. She's really funny in it.
She takes over for Melinda Dillon, who, you know, who's nominated for Supporting Actress in Close Encounters. But she takes over from Melinda Dillon, and I think that the difference is... I think that's probably the biggest difference, because Julie Haggerty... definitely has her own version of Mrs. Parker, and it's not the version from the original one.
Yeah, she's a little more aloof in this, and
she's
grieving, so I don't blame her.
Right, but it's also like I think the Julie Haggerty's type of comedy comes through, and it's natural because it's a different act. Yeah. You know, it's a different actor, so that actor is going to bring what they have to the table. It's just a little different, I guess. But it's not a bad thing. It's just it's also like, you know, if you're watching, maybe if you were binge watching the first and second one, there's you know, it's I guess maybe just a little more
and
of a jarring.
Melinda Dillon definitely plays that sort of 80s type mom in A Christmas Story, and like just kind of unconditional love type mom, you know, right, in that. And in this one, it's still, it's just a very different.
Which is also like, I think you can chalk it up to like just being like, you know, softening over the character, softening over time. Cause like, you know, she's obviously an older character this time. But in the original one, she was kind of like almost like a no nonsense type of person, like the dad almost in a way. Like it's just, It's characterized very differently, but, both cool. I just think that they're just both different. Like, you know, the performances, I guess, are different.
Yeah. And I mean, there's, I think the whole thing revolves around Billingsley and his ability to channel like an older Ralphie. Obviously, yeah.
He does it pretty well.
It'd be totally different if he did not sign on and they recast like The Rock or something in this. But like, I feel like he does such a fantastic job of playing. I mean, he is an older version of the young kid, but to have him kind of match a lot of the same like physical stuff, like the way he uses his face is still exactly the same that he did in the first one. And I think that went such a long way for. You know, making it really believable and still feel a lot like the first Christmas story. But yeah, cool. Well, do you have something, Drew?
I just wanted to... Oh, my bad. I was going to give a shout out to... you're going to press a button?
No.
I was going to give a shout out to Juliana Lane as Julie Parker, the daughter of Ralph, and River Droesch as Mark Parker, the son of Ralph. The kids are really cool in this movie. The kids are all right. Yeah, they're really funny. Like, I think they might be the smartest people in this movie. Like, you know,
even the Bumpus kid is funny.
Well, they don't act. Yeah, they seemed a little smarter than their adult counterparts. That's why it's one of those things where the universe where like, you know, the kids are a little smarter than the adults. They're great. You know, I think both of them kind of hold their own. They're very witty, and also that the Delbert. The Bumpus kid next door, like he's also really funny.
Funny,
yeah. I really think I like that. There's a way that this town is 33 years removed from the first one, but still feels a lot. It feels the same, including the kid, like everyone next door. Like it all is still there, and so him returning kind of makes, you know, has a really big impact. Well, we really like this movie, it sounds like. So bye. No, I'm just kidding. Let's go around the horn and give our final thoughts on A Christmas Story. Christmas. Remember, it is the holidays, so also ho 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 to everyone out there.
Ho motherfucking ho.
Drew, what are your final thoughts on A Christmas Story Christmas, streaming now on HBO Max?
I liked it. I think it goes, it's pretty much almost as it's pretty, it's as good as the first one, I think, for sure. I don't know if it's better because it still isn't too...
it's not iconic yet.
Yeah, exactly. But I can see this being a Christmas story for kids that grow up later. Does that make sense? Yeah. Like this one could be on a block, and this is the one that they put on instead of the other one. But it boils down to, we were talking about that, you know, that scene at the end where, you know, the grandpa ends up getting him all the gifts and stuff like that, which I think is crazy because the first one is about wanting this gift and then not appreciating it and not seeing the thought that went into it. Like, it's almost like this is the parent side of it, if that makes sense. Where like, what if the first movie had followed the dad and the mom and they really tried the hardest, like, no, we can't get him this gun and stuff like that until they ultimately break down because they love their son enough to do it and they get him this thing.
And the dogs even eat their perfect dinner.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
They're fine.
Like, and so that's what this one is too, where it's like, man, it's not about the gifts. Like, it was never about the gifts. And he kind of learns that there at the end and stuff like that, where it's about, it literally, they say it in the movie, where it's the thought that counts. And that's what Ralphie learns to appreciate here, both in his old town and his old friends and in his family and in himself. But it you just don't picture that type of thought in a Christmas sequel.
Yeah.
So many. How many Christmas sequels are like actually good? Almost none of them, because they all get franchised, and then there's three or four of them and stuff like that, and it just kind of rocks it till the wheels fall off. But this one, it was literally 30 plus years in the making, and it kind of, I think it delivered as best as it could have.
Yeah. I think it was also put together pretty quickly. I think I looked it up, and it was like, it was announced of January of this year, January 2022.
And again, it should have been worse if that's the case, for sure.
Yeah. And they still did that really fun thing of kind of closing up this story and making it about him being and the narrator.
I just didn't think that this was going to give new life to the first one also, which it does.
New context. Yeah. It's like the Andor of A Christmas Story. John, what do you think of this movie?
I mean, Drew put it, you know, he put it nicely. I think it's just like, it's cool. You don't ever get a movie... It's not you don't ever get a movie, but like most movies, when they bank on nostalgia, it's kind of like, you know, you kind of, it's wild because, like, you know, it can go either a very cynical way or, you know, very, like, you know, cringy way or something.
It's about the symbols and the icons.
Right. And this one kind of does it, but it's also like, it's kind of, I don't know if it gets a pass, but to me, it gets a pass because of Christmas. You know, Christmas is a nostalgic holiday. And I think the movie does, like what Drew kind of said, which is like, it kind of, it makes you feel nostalgia, but it also, like, the ultimately the movie is like, you know, obviously, like, remember the past, you know, be enthralled by it and stuff, but be grateful for what you have today, you know, which is pretty cool. Like, you know, nostalgia works, but ultimately, like, you know, it's good to know what you have right now. Like, you know, and so I think that's pretty cool. And that's a really kind of positive message to come from, like, a legacy sequel from a movie that, like, you know, literally like decades ago. And that's like, it's wild that, like, it's we're not saying that this is the next great Christmas movie and stuff like that, but it is a very, the fact that you get those kind of themes and this is very enjoyable and then it's not like a complete, like, bore or failure is wild. And so, like, A Christmas Story, Christmas, you know, title aside, like, gets a pass for me, and it probably will make, like, you know, the Christmas rotation of movies for me in the future. Like, I definitely see myself rewatching this, you know, for holiday seasons to come.
Yeah, it's a very modern, thoughtful, I guess, like, added context type of movie.
Yeah.
And I mean, if you add on the fact that a lot of the child actors, and it's produced by, like, Vince Vaughn, and it's produced by all these people who are connected to child actors, like, the fact that it's them being able to even, on the meta side, interrogate and work through their nostalgia for their careers... You know, like, this is the biggest thing Billy's ever done, was the first Christmas Story. Now he's able to, like, help write with this story, co-produce.
And he's a lead in this one?
And lead in this movie. It's a very rare thing, and it kind of works great.
Yeah, it doesn't,
from Iron Man and Spider-Man to leading man.
Well, it's also like, it's like, this doesn't happen. Like, no, it's just, it doesn't happen. It has, like, all the all
You hear horror stories about child actors.
Yeah, this is the recipe. It's like, even if it was going to be, like, air, like, this should be a disaster, and it's not.
And I think I really appreciate that. I love that they still captured...
We didn't say anything about this. There's a weird scene where a bunch of drunks steal, like, sleds from kids.
It's so wild. Well, that's, like, I'm glad that it captures, like, you talk about the drunks stealing sleds, but, you know, it still is anecdotal in a way. Like, there's still kind of disconnected things that are just... normal stuff that happens around Christmas, like, you have to go shopping.
Right.
So here's some crazy stuff that happens when you go shopping. You get in a snowball fight. Here's some crazy stuff. Carolers come. Like, it's still kind of that. And it still captures a lot of the Gene Shepherd, I guess I would call him, like, witticisms or whatever. Like, then, the way that he talks
There's a something, but behind a nothing, there's a whole lot of something. It's very old timey.
Yeah, and I like that. And even that feels a lot like the first Christmas Story. So I'm glad that they kept a bunch of that. But it is a very modern movie that it feels different in a way that isn't bad. It just is not. Happy 100% of the time,
right,
which is okay. And I feel like that's why it feels modern, because, you know, not life is not happy 100%. Movies aren't anymore.
It doesn't also treat, like, your audience dumb. Like, it knows that you're there to watch some of the tropes of A Christmas Story, but it does, like, doesn't talk down to you. Like, it's a real movie with actual, like,
it's cool super themes. Relatable, because it's about what Christmas is really about, which is family.
Yeah. And yeah, you're right.
And not gifts.
The first one is universal in a different way. And this one is universal in a different way, too. Like, you know, growing up, losing family members, kind of, like, learning what your parents went through and kind of, you know, respecting them and appreciating them a lot more. Like, it's still incredibly universal. And I think it feels like we're not getting Christmas Story 3. Like, this is kind of a great way too. I mean, I don't know.
But we might get a Christmas Story 3 with this kid. Maybe he'll like it. And like
in 20 years, baby, we're going to follow the one-eyed daughter.
Yeah, but it's a cool. Yeah.
A Christmas Story New Year's or something.
My gosh. That's what I said. I said a Christmas story.
Easter. Christmas story. We'll see. But we've come to the end of this episode. Again, happy holidays. I know, like, the way that the week's lined up, this is coming out a full 6 days before Christmas, because Christmas is on a Sunday this year or something like that.
Is it really?
Yeah. Man, so this is coming out the Monday before that. So it's like a long way off still, but you're in the spirit of things, you know? So
yeah, you still get that
second
week off, I guess, after the Sunday that happens or something.
Maybe. Let's go around the horn. Apart from like happy holidays and stuff, Drew, what do you have to plug?
Mainly the Countdown Strikes Back. We finished our Andor season, and from when we're recording this, the finale is tonight, so I'm fucking pumped, and we're going to record that. Yeah,
I'm
excited.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Anyway, Darth Vader popped up. I'm just kidding. But yeah, and so check that out. I'm sure Emmanuel just got 5 new High Republic books in the mail.
Good. So the one I sent you, it's like so bright. It's so different than the other one.
It's funny. You had texted me and I had my copy at the store because we ordered the books for me.
You know what I'm talking about, right? Tarantino's book? It looks different. It's different.
Edgar Wright read Tarantino's book in a single city.
Wow. I've done that to some books. I don't think you'll ever do it to Tarantino. Mostly like mystery books I read.
Really. So yeah, the Countdown Strikes Back, and then check out the Dirt Sheet Radio. They just recorded from when we're recording this, their 100th episode. By the time you listen to it, they're at 150 or something. No, jeez,
yeah,
they were fast over there.
So yeah, if you like the professional wrestling world, check them out.
John, what do you have to plug?
I'm gonna plug Countdown to Infinity. I think that is still going on. It's in the title, you know, to infinity. They haven't gotten there yet
and beyond.
So.
We'll end with the next one. I'm just kidding.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Check that out. I think our Black Panther podcast should still be doing the rounds. I think it's kind of quiet between now and the
Guardians Christmas special.
The Guardians Christmas special should be pretty cool.
And early February is already Quantumania, which is wild.
Yeah, that's wild. I mean, yeah, there's a little break from Marvel. Just you get a nap in, and then they're bombarding you with more
not
shit.
Not really that long.
But yeah, check out the Countdown to Infinity podcast. That is some exciting stuff with Delphin and Sophie. And, oh shit, sorry, I felt something coming up my leg. God damn it, Drew. Happy holidays, guys, and please be safe. Get vaxxed if you're not vaxxed. And, you know, if you're sick, just wear a mask. Sorry, I'm digging myself into a hole.
I also felt something up my leg.
Yeah.
Drew's doing the splits over here. Thanks so much for listening to the pod. Have a great holidays. You will hear us, and maybe there's like a New Year's sequel.
I think we're getting close to. Well, we're getting close to some Pandora action, aren't we?
Well, that's going to come out before this.
And some actual.
By the time they're listening, they've heard us rave.
Yeah,
about the 3-hour Pandora sucked.
I don't eat these raw, but if they're sautéed, I love glass onions.
Okay.
I hate cooking, but I love to stir the pot.
Wait, what?
Bye.